Great. Hey, everybody. Woj back for another episode of the Vectra AI podcast and familiar face. We brought John back again for this
one. Folks.
If you, we've done a couple of these, scattered spider, phishing, ransomware, all the many faces of identity attacks. We usually bring John in to talk about those, amongst other things. But this one's interesting. So as you can see by the title slide, Gen AI driven attacks. If there ever a buzzword right now, would probably be Gen AI. So I'm like, hey, John, let's sit down and let's talk about what the heck is a Gen AI attack? And, you know, that's what this threat briefing is about. I think we try to keep these things pretty, you know, rooted in fundamental questions that we think security buyers have. Is like, and I want John to kind of walk through these things. We're going to, you know, put him in the hot seat a little bit. And well, not really a hot seat. You've prepared some background information in Slideware, which I guess wouldn't be a hot seat, so to speak. But this is predominantly unrehearsed, I would say. But here are some things that I want to know. I think, you know, some of our listeners and watchers might want to know. It's like, okay, what in the first place is a Gen AI threat? What is the threat, right? We use this term, you know, what is a Gen AI attack? How does it work? How does it manifest? And then third, who cares? Why does this matter for our friends in the SOC, right? So I'll throw the first question at you, John. What are we talking about? What is the Gen AI threat that we should be talking about?
So I think to talk about what is the threat, I want to just like level set on what Gen AI is. So generative AI is, I mean, it's all the buzz. It's the technology that's powering these consumer tools like ChatGPT, Gemini, Meta AI, Midjourney, all these kind of AI tools that are based off of large corpuses of text, images, whatever, fed into these AIs that ultimately let users ask questions, write documents, generate images, all this stuff. And what's getting really interesting now is that AI is now coming into the enterprises. All last year, it was all on the consumer side. Gen AI is now in the enterprise. It's live. It's Microsoft is now charging for it. It's part of their products. We're talking to customers who are bringing it in-house, building their own LLMs, generative AI tools. It is now commonplace. And as we're seeing consumers, enterprises adopting it, so too are attackers. And there's studies now that are getting put out there, a recent study by Microsoft and kind of the folks at OpenAI came out and found the attack groups that they say have the TTPs associated using with this Gen AI tech. And these are doing things, and this is just a taste of kind of what a Gen AI attack is, but these are things like using LLMs, using these large language models, using ChatGPT to kind of figure out what to do for reconnaissance, to enhancing their ability to do scripting, to social engineer, kind of manage language, do translation. All these things are just kind of the tip of the iceberg of what they are starting to do as attackers with these kind of really powerful AI tools.
They're in a nutshell. We've talked about this in the past. It's like latency is an attacker's dream and kind of nightmare at the same time. And it is for the SOC as well. Like latency is a nightmare. And if you look at this, it's like, I'm going to use Gen AI to do remove latency out of all of these processes so I can move faster, so I can get things done faster as an attacker, as an employee or a consumer, as an enterprise. It's like everyone's getting more productive, right? At the same time. Well, I would argue maybe not at the same time. Some are getting more productive than others.
It's exactly it. I mean, it's speed. This is a speed game. I mean, you're stealing my thunder on my third question, but this, you know, this is the, you know, this is what this all leads to. And to kind of make it more legit, even, this has now become a kind of such a concept of Gen AI and attackers, where now MITRE has even started to have a kind of a role in the conversation. So MITRE ATT&CK is ultimately a language that kind of defenders have to talk about what attackers do. this adversarial threat landscape for artificial intelligence systems Atlas framework came out. It's not kind of official MITRE. It's very, 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 or MITRE attack, very close. But they're calling out 56 different techniques that are all centered on just this Gen AI concept. And so when you have this type of language, it is a real situation in terms of defenders needing to pay attention if you've got this many things that you could say an attacker is going to do here.
Which probably leads to our kind of next question. Like, okay, what is the threat? It's been recognized. MITRE's Microsoft's giving it attention. MITRE's giving it attention. You know, from our perspective, like, this is the second question. It's like, how do these Gen AI attacks work? How do they manifest? What's happening from the attacker's point of view?
Yeah. And I think this is super useful for folks to just like internalize that this isn't like a theoretical. And so we look through like, what does this look like? What is a Gen AI attack? Like, let's bring it down to actually a sequence of events that an attacker is going to run. So you have your threat actor. This could be almost any one of those list of attackers that I just kind of mentioned before. And what can happen is that attack can start with a phishing email, just like kind of a lot of our kind of threat actors that we're tracking out there are doing. But the key thing that, you know, is happening on the back end where we start to bleed that Gen AI language in is that the entire text that's, you know, included in that email that drives the phishing, the landing page, all generated with Gen AI, all built with ChatGPT. There's literally attack frameworks on the dark web that are like hackers' version of ChatGPT that are all designed to kind of help make this easier, really tuning towards the attacker mindset, but removing things like being able to deal with translation, being able to take in context, being able to be convincing with the assistance of an AI ultimately. And so just like a regular attack, this type of phishing can bypass MFA, they grab tokens, land in the environment, sign in with a identity. And because ultimately, you know, most attacks right now, identity is the new kind of entryway in, and Gen AI is a great way to get that going faster in terms of that access point. What gets real interesting though is once you're in, when you have enterprise tools like Copilot for Microsoft 365, just like how that as a tool makes defenders' lives easier, makes them operate faster, when an attacker accesses it, signs into using Copilot from Microsoft 365, their attack actually also speeds up. And so what they can start doing is typing into the console, the kind of Copilot console, just like a kind of ChatGPT, just search bar console, start asking questions. I want to register a new device, show me documentation now. And what'll happen is it'll go through, parse through all the documents that are in kind of SharePoint, emails, whatever in the kind of compromised users Microsoft world, and it'll come up with the exact instructions from those documents, how to register a device, what kind of MFA policies are in place, anything that's out there, it'll pull it down. And that lets the attacker then instantly go, just like they were in a normal attack, but even faster, move to register their own device. So now they've got persistence in this environment. The AI piece is running, but the attacker is still doing their standard playbook. It's only getting faster with the kind of augmentation of something like Copilot. That's just the tip, though, because ultimately there's got to be some action on an objective. So they may start using the ChatGPT, or sorry, the Copilot client to start asking for more data, ask it for things like files and passwords that are sensitive. Now, Copilot itself has some rules. It'll say, hey, I can't give you passwords. That's like a no-go. I'm not your hacking tool. But there's this concept that we've seen proved out where you can jailbreak. You can ask the right questions. You can convince it. You can coax it. And it'll give you this information. It'll show you the files. It'll show you the data. And that becomes the path then for the attacker to really navigate. So they can gather all the data they need, all the sensitive files. And then it becomes a null holds bar with that identity to move laterally against other M365 apps, AWS, Azure, the network, everything, ultimately action on objective to get to data theft and impact.
This, as you're walking through this, I couldn't help but think about Gen AI, or in this example, Copilot, as commoditizing the sophisticated attack. Once was, you know, the methodology of a sophisticated attacker has now been commoditized and made simple for even the, you know, the most simple or basic of hackers that have some level of novice talent or whatnot. So there's not only a speed thing here, there's also like a barrier to entry little bit on the attacker side. So this is helpful.
Yeah, it's fun even when, you know, you play with this thing, you don't even have to spell your questions right? Like, you know, like the search is just give me this and it's going to parent it right out for you. It's that easy.
So at the end of the day, what does this mean for the SOC? Like, kind of in a nutshell, John, it's like, you know, we often get questions like, do we look at Gen AI as a new attack surface? Do we look at it as a new, you know, kind of methodology for the attacker? Is it a tool? Is it like, what is it? And what does this mean for defenders?
So I kind of have three things to call it, and there's probably even more, but I think just to be like quick with this, Gen AI is a force multiplier for everyone, and I really mean everyone. It is, you know, a piece of technology that can be used by everyone in an enterprise environment to do more work, better work, faster work, but it just also means that attackers in their enterprises and their goals, they are going to be using it too as a force multiplier to move faster and to progress their attacks forward. The thing is, it is just a tool. Just like kind of for us as end users, ChatGPT isn't taking away kind of massive jobs. We still have to do the work. Same thing for attackers. They have to still do the work. So they still need to work towards action on objective. They still need to do the things they would normally do. So an identity attack with generative AI involved isn't just a generative AI attack. It is an identity attack that's going to move faster, that's going to have these advantages of the AI helping them, but all the same rules in place. Even in that example, they still have to go that step of registering device, signing in, moving across and going laterally. All those things still play out, even with the AI as the backdrop of how they get through. And that piece there, like that's the call out too. It's not like the AI just instantly goes in and there's no trace of what happens. You know, throughout this process, on that last example, attacker signing in, that's detectable. Some of these usage of Copilot, those things are detectable. The registering device, that's detectable. All these things, there's breadcrumbs the attacker leaves, even in the Gen AI world, that you can detect and stop these types of attacks.
Now, the key, though, is the speed at which you can detect those, which is where AI comes. This is like fighting AI with AI.
100%.
So, like, I'm not going to get into the Vectra AI pitch here for us because that's a separate podcast. It's like there's a separate podcast coming on. Okay, what are you guys doing about this? But the speed thing is, there is an element here or something that, you know, the fact that the attacker is leveraging this, leveraging AI to move at speed, just so, you know, and Microsoft has done this with Copilot, Security Copilot, is like from an investigation standpoint, moving at speed. But I'd also detection at speed can only be done by AI as well, behavior-based AI. And we'll get into that in a separate podcast, but I hear you.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, this is awesome. I hope everybody tuning in found this. This is like the you know, one of many of conversations we're probably going to have across with John, with Fabian, with others that have been guests on the podcast. Thanks again for tuning in. If this is the first Vectra AI podcast you've chimed into, we just talk, you know, candidly, openly about stuff, different threat briefings and our perspectives on scattered spider, our perspectives on SOC and SOC value, all sorts of things, just candid conversations. So if you haven't checked out our other ones, please do. They're all out on YouTube for everyone to see. We have a bunch more coming out over the course of the next few weeks. And yeah, we're actually doing some rapid fire ones too. 3 questions in 3 minutes or less. So, they're not all going to be 10, 15, 20, 30 minutes. So, tune in when you can. So again, John, thanks as always. This was fantastic. And, until the next time, thanks everybody.